Funding for Frontline is provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide, and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Tonight on Frontline, it's not Miami Vice. It's real cops, real crime, real danger.
The streets are like the jungle in a way. It's like who's going to be clever, who's going to like survive.
It's like an avalanche that keeps coming and coming. And you know, you put your finger in here and bam, it comes out. You go over here, you know, you just can't stop it.
Violence, drugs, and the fight to make a difference. Tonight, Street Cop.
From the network of public television stations, a presentation of KCTS Seattle, WNET New York, WPBT Miami, WTBS Detroit, and WGBH Boston. This is Frontline with Judy Woodruff.
Good evening. If your view of police work has been shaped by Miami Vice or Hill Street Blues, our story will change that. Tonight, real police, real crime, and real danger. For 10 months, Frontline has been inside one special unit of the Boston Police Department, in one special section of the city where drugs and related crime are most concentrated. Tonight, you will see that film. And then, because we think it raises issues larger than just the Boston police force, we have asked three experts from three different cities and perspectives to analyze the film. A warning: the language in the film is the language of the streets, and it is strong and may be offensive to some viewers. And now, Street Cop, produced by Richard Kahn.
Boston, Massachusetts. Last year, there were nearly 32,000 arrests here. Close to one-third of them happened in one small section of the inner city. There's an urban war zone like this in every city, where the police are the foot soldiers in the war on crime. One of them is a 26-year veteran street cop.
Hey, brother. Okay.
Bravo 423.
Give me a 40, will you?
Sergeant Stanley Philbin knows these streets. He grew up near here, and now he works in projects like this.
Everybody's in business. Tough place to live, though, I'll tell you. You know, if I was poor and if I was black and I was living down here, I'd probably be out there selling drugs myself, trying to make a buck to get out of here. You know, it's no bargain being poor, and it's no bargain being black, I'm sure. And it's no fucking bargain living down here in this shithole. Imagine living down here.
They call this part of the city District 2, Area B. This is where you come if you want to do real police work. Close to half the Boston area drug arrests happen here. After 14 years in more affluent sections of Boston, Philbin asked to return here to lead a group of plainclothes police called the Anti-Crime Unit.
Good morning, Lieutenant. We're going to be doing a thing today in about 45 minutes at 528 Woodhill Avenue, apartment 9. We have a guy up there.
The Anti-Crime Unit exists primarily to interrupt drug traffic on the streets. A half dozen cops who make more than 1,000 arrests a year.
I know you did, Lieutenant, but he also sold to Trent 2 days ago. And Trent's going back today to pick up a half pound for $3.30.
Philbin calls Trent the secret weapon. He buys drugs undercover.
Make that nice and secure.
He has a little baby face. He looks like a little cherub.
I just want to make sure the mic's deep.
You know? People trust Trent on the street. Trent is the perfect guy to buy drugs.
See you today.
Oh, okay.
Mark Vickers is my favorite cop. Mark, you know, give Mark a shotgun. He's not going to shoot somebody by accident. You know, he's a captain in the Army Reserves. He's a gun collector. And he's dependable. He's not like a silly little kid.
Lloyd Margo, we're going to do that.
Lloyd Wizard, quality young cop. Fastest guy I ever met in the job. You can chase down anybody. No one can escape Lloyd Wizard.
So what's the truth? Get the warrant, we're going to do it.
No, I mean, what's the floor plan of the building?
Oh, I'm going to give you the home of Giller as soon as everybody's here.
Which one? He said we're going to do two.
Margo Warner? He's got a tough job working with all guys in a really tough neighborhood. It's not easy for Margo. And she does the same thing we do, but we use Margo extra for searching females.
I got a throat cut. Yeah?
A drug user has had his throat cut.
Why?
Drugs more than
that. The hot guy?
Yeah. The only department we're going in is the drug house.
There is at least one murder every week in this precinct.
The whole place problem with cops doing undercover buys and the guy commits a murder right there in the mall.
Blood. I see a stream of blood going around the corner.
Half of the murders in the city of Boston are drug related.
What's the charge of time?
Certainly all the murders, and most of the murders in Roxbury are.
You don't know, Margo may like me.
All my officers, they're all black officers, and we deal mainly with black people. But I think black officers should work in black neighborhoods. They should work in white neighborhoods, too. A lot of people disagree.
You hit me with that hammer. You wish you had it. Maybe not me.
The unit is getting ready for a drug bust.
Channel 3.
These two officers will cover the back door. Trent, the undercover cop, is wearing a hidden microphone.
Yeah. So
this is the third time Trent has bought drugs here.
I say he's coming down, then we're going to do it. Ready? Okay. Okay, 981 to Trent. Let's go.
He's in the building. He's knocking on the door. Okay, they recognize him. They're not selling to him. We're going to do it anyway, right now. Let's do it. Okay, Mike.
All right.
All we do is drugs, drugs, drugs. It's all the boss wants us to do is drugs, drugs, drugs. And that's the biggest problem in the district. It's the biggest problem in the city. It's the biggest problem in the country.
Stop! Please, don't move!
Don't move!
Don't move!
Come here!
Hey!
Hey,
Roman,
stop!
Why
are you running like that?
Wait! No!
You know, one starts screaming, the next one starts, before you know it, they're all freaking yelling.
We're at number 2 Folsom Avenue, apartment 3, executing a search warrant. And can you have those back door people come upstairs, please?
They were just angry at our presence in there. They knew that we were there to lock them up. They had sold drugs twice to Trent.
We have a search warrant.
We were there on a lawful legal search warrant.
Yes, you did. You sold drugs to a police officer.
That's my stepfather. He's not here. Okay. Let me call my sister.
So that's why we're here. So calm down. Just be calm. Very emotional people are Spanish brothers and sisters. But we have to get their names before they leave. We don't want these people. We're going to take Mother. She sold the train.
Let her go. Can I check her for warrants?
No,
just
let her go.
Ask her where the marijuana is so we can just get out of here.
You had your white clothes, you put them in your
wet. Ask her where the marijuana is.
Without putting it on the
dog. Ask her where it is.
You got to make those
pink color pencils. The marijuana?
Where?
Yeah, that's, yeah, I understand.
I understand.
Mother.
Little while.
Mother.
Can you sit
bring down here?
She gets one phone call.
She can have five phone calls. No problem. We just got the nickel, we got the coke, and we got two hand-to-hand buys. I mean, that's all the fuck we need. I mean, I don't care if we... I keep telling you, this is not... it's not Miami Vice.
Six police officers, four working days. No drugs are found. The 64-year-old woman and her 14-year-old stepson have been arrested. The case will rest on the testimony of an undercover cop and finding the marked money.
She has so much in there, I could see it bulging out.
Yeah. Well, what we're looking for, Marie, is our 20s, the Trent Bart.
The 20s?
Yeah, but so far we haven't found him. We probably won't. I don't really give a shit. You know, he's already identified him.
Here's a 20 right here.
Yeah. These are the two numbers here.
Okay, yeah, because I'm a classified.
And possession of class B.
Yeah.
That's it.
And an unlawful distribution of class D. Because she sold one time, too.
The 64-year-old woman and her stepson were bailed out 4 hours later when the paperwork was completed.
Just a wallet?
She was charged with possession. 9 months later, the case is still pending.
Yeah.
We should sort of have some kind of organization to our searches.
Well,
we tend to tear everything up and then we get confused.
Well, everything we've done... Everything.
I mean, we've come up with some good stuff.
Margo.
You know, the Spanish people, they hide us good.
I know, but Marie, I must tell you... I must tell you that everything we do is on the job training. I didn't go to no goddamn school. You didn't go to no goddamn school, right?
That's true.
All right. So what the fuck? We do the best we can.
That's true.
Hey, Ronnie. Hey, if I had to be something, this is what I want to be. A cop.
You want to be commissioner?
Well, I wouldn't want to be commissioner, but I wouldn't mind getting commissioner's pay. I'll tell you that. But I don't want to be stuck in some office, shuffling papers, answering phones, going to meetings. That's no fun. Someone's got to do it, right? Let Commissioner Roach do it. I like this shit.
By his own account, in 26 years, he's shot at 10 people. He's hit 3, killed no one, and made 8,000 arrests. He's been kicked, punched, pummeled, spit on. And today, he and his team will go through it all one more time.
Okay, 2 days ago, Trent went up to 528 Bluell Avenue where he bought $50 worth of grass. No big deal, right? But he went back yesterday and he tried to make another one before we did our search warrant. The guy says he's out for 5 o'clock tonight, which was last night. Trent made arrangements to buy a half a pound for $330. Trent's got $330 in marked money right now. Trent's going up there right now. We're going to listen to him. We have the wire. But Greg and Bob, what I like you gentlemen to do is go in the rear alley. But don't let him see you like when he looks out the window, because he might try to flee. He can climb down, you know. But if you gentlemen can get under the porch, and you can, you know, just as he's reaching the ground level, if he tries to flee in that direction, yeah, you can grab him, because we want our $330 back.
Oh, all right. Okay, ready, folks?
Yep.
You want to keep that, Michael? Okay.
It's taken 5 days to put this bus together. Trent has bought drugs undercover. Stanley has used that evidence to get a search warrant from the court. It's a process that could go on day and night. There's no shortage of drugs.
Grove Hall, Packer and Tremont, the Triangle, Sonoma Street, Eggleston Square, that store over there, that store there, you know, houses, corners, parks, schoolyards, gas stations, liquor stores, parking lots.
drugs, Richard, you could probably go into that store right there and ask for two nickels, and you'll come up with two bags of marijuana. You could go over that store over there and ask him for a blow of cocaine, and you probably get a good shot at buying it.
Nothing. I don't have nothing.
Nothing. Nothing. For me.
But today, the unit is out of luck. The suspect is out of drugs.
Yeah. Where you running from?
We got 7 days, no problem. We got 7 days. They're just out. Can you back out down the street?
Yeah, we're doing so now. We'll meet you back in the house.
The day won't end here. Now they'll look for drugs on the streets. Kenny Dorch and Mark Vickers have been partners for 5 years. Together, they made over 700 drug-related arrests in 1986.
People on the street, when they see Mark and Kenny, they want to cross the street. But if they get stopped and they're dirty, Mark and Kenny are going to take them in. That's no question about it.
They know this neighborhood. They live near here. And on this corner, where lots of drugs are sold, they think they've just seen a sale. Kenny thinks he's found the evidence.
Got something here.
That ain't mine.
Huh?
It ain't mine.
Huh?
For real. Shit ain't mine, man. I'm telling you the truth, man. That shit ain't mine. I'm standing up against the fence, man. I ain't doing a motherfucking thing, man. And I stand right here, man. And I ain't running from nobody, man.
I know.
You know what I'm saying?
Don't do it. Don't do it.
I ain't running from nobody, man. You know what I'm saying? I don't have to run from nobody.
Hey, kids, go ahead. Go ahead. We'll play. Go.
That shit ain't mine, man. I had a half a pint of liquor, man. You got that sitting on the seat. That's all I had.
Ooh.
That's all I had. You know what I'm saying? I got my money in my motherfucking pocket. You know what I'm saying?
Ooh.
It's yours.
Drop it.
You can't prove it. It's not mine, man.
I don't have to prove it.
You're going to have to unprove it.
You're going to have to disprove it. Say it wasn't yours.
It's not mine, man. All I got in my pocket is $40, man. What I had when I came up here, man, and a half a pint of liquor, man, and a pack of cigarettes, man.
For a speedball.
Ain't no speedball, man. For real, man.
For a speedball.
No, it's not, man. I don't fuck around, man. I drink liquor, man. I had half a pint of cigarette gin, man. That's all I had, man.
Come on, Virginia.
Okay, we have it. Benefit of the doubt, Chief. This time. Next time, not so fucking lucky. All right? Shoot PC him.
I can walk now? Huh?
He was dirty. This shit was his. That was his. He was nervous.
Oh, shit, yeah.
Yeah.
I ain't doing nothing.
Hey, man.
We just can't see the whole picture. You know, all we see is from our level. We see, because we're right down there in the middle of the stuff, right down there where it's all dirty and everything else. Go through people's trash cans looking for drugs, you know, that they discard and stuff like that, knowing that if it's their first or second time, they're going to beat it in court. You know, but we go through this stuff. We go through the aggravation, looking for all of this stuff, going in these people's houses and doing all this. You know, knowing that they're not going to, if they're convicted, nothing's going to happen to them. I mean, you know, and that's kind of like a disheartening thing at times. But, you know, the way I look at it is that you got to build things like a stepping stone. You got to start someplace. And if you keep chipping away at these people, you get enough arrests, you know, about the sixth or seventh time they're convicted, they will do some time. All right, and you have
another bust. Trent has bought drugs and is going out the back door. Stanley is afraid one of his cops, Carl, will be discovered.
Oh, look at fucking Carl.
Where?
Carl, is that Carl?
Where?
We're standing right there.
The suspect was arrested for dealing drugs just 2 weeks ago.
Get Carl out of here.
Hey, Carl!
Okay, disregard. Back door's open. Okay, we're going in the front. He's going up the back. We're going in the front. Okay, we got to get in the front. We're not right here. We'll never get in the second house.
Here, Mark.
Come on. on the floor. Sit down. Sit down. Be cool.
Don't move.
Anybody else in here? Be cool.
We ain't doing nothing here.
Don't move. Okay, you got any guns in the house?
You got nothing.
Got any drugs
here,
in the house?
Nothing.
You have any money?
Nothing.
Stand up.
I got my money from my job.
Let me see.
You got no money from my job.
Let me see. Let me see. What else? Just be cool.
I'm not taking no more risks.
So you sit down.
Go back and sit down.
You sit down, young lady. Bravo 981.
981.
Can I have that BK1 haul and go to 7?
BK1, go to 7.
Well, not a big score, but what the fuck, it's what the boss wants.
They found $50 worth of marijuana.
And we'll just keep looking.
But the search warrant covers only this apartment.
We got our money back, used on the buy.
Getting all back?
Yeah. But there's got to be a stash around here, but he's probably got it down in the vacant apartment.
Yeah, it's down there. There's no lights on down there.
He had the friggin' stash in one of them vacant apartments.
Yeah.
Right? But we got our money back. We got two buys, so we got a good, you know, we're going to get it guilty. There's no problem there.
There's another side of being a street cop.
Hacking away.
It's not all flak jackets, handcuffs, and guns. It's also endless paperwork, court appearances,
tonight,
and office politics.
Yes, I just need to, you know, list
Stanley spends as much time here as on the streets.
You want to go with him, Stanley?
Well, the Celtics are playing tonight, boss.
I didn't even mention that to him, you know. I'm going to miss the game.
I have all that information. Of course, I'm on a day off. Just get out of court.
The boss wants Stanley's help calming residents of a housing development called Academy Homes. Stanley wants something in return.
That's no problem.
His unit has only one car, but it has been broken down for a week. They've been told to get a taxi, but the cab company won't give him one.
All right. I've got some good arrests up there for you to lay on the people, but we do have further problems, boss. We have to have at least one vehicle. We've been grounded, you know, for about a week.
I just got a call from Lieutenant Devine. He wants to know what cab companies those were that aren't giving us cabs.
Only one cab company we've been going to is Checker Taxi.
Checker, and they've just been coming up with the excuse they don't have any, right?
That's affirmative.
Okay. I got to call him back.
Okay, I got three things for Wilbur. One good search warrant, two arrests. They're going to court this week, as a matter of fact. These are two non-residents of the Academy Home who go down there and ply their trade. They sell drugs. So we have two going to court this week.
Look, the problem is just watching the place. That's the problem, right?
The problem is, boss, that the problem that they have with the Academy Homes, they have in numberless locations in the district. People are calling us, come here, come here, come here. We can only be at one place at one time. And one operation takes up a total day, usually. So the people at the Academy Homes, they have a legitimate beef. Where's the police? Where's the police? The police are working, but they just don't happen to be working at Academy Homes that day. They're at the Triangle. They're at Sonoma Street. They're at Grove Hall. They're on Oakwood Street. They're at Parker and Smith, Parker and Tremont. Drugs galore are rampant, you know, in the district. We can spend some more time up Academy Homes. It would be nice if we had an apartment up there. They would be
breaking. We don't want to say to them that drugs are rampant all over the district and we're someplace else. They don't want to hear that. We can't tell them that. So what we got to do is, we've been there. We've made three arrests.
However, that we did not solve the problem. The problem still exists. The problem, you know, we're going to go to court. Well, all these people are going to go to court. Now, one of these people here are going to go to the can. That's part of the problem.
Where were these drugs located?
Drugs aren't the only problem in this neighborhood. And Stanley and his anti-crime unit aren't the only kind of cops.
Did she come to your home?
Most of the police here wear uniforms.
No, I came here.
They ride in patrol cars, respond to radio calls, and keep the peace in the rest of the community.
When they go on them radio calls, you know, to house calls, family trouble, cut and shootings, like I say, automobile accidents, robberies. They get everything. They do all the police work. They do all the police work, everything. They do that. They're the frontline troops.
How long since you ever called back?
Police. Spouse abuse, battering, assault with a dangerous weapon. The police call them domestic disturbances.
Down there in the far side?
Yeah.
This is the third time they've been called here.
You never got the restraining order?
I did, but it.
Who called the police? Who called the police here?
Nothing anymore.
Sit down. Sit down and relax. Was there any violence here tonight?
Yeah, he boxed me in the face and he took me out of the kitchen. I said he's got to kill me. And he tear up my blouse and my bra. See, he tear up my clothes. I have to go. I can't stay here. No.
When are you going to cut it out? When are you going to stop?
Okay, you want to stop me? I'm going to go away. I've been in jail already. I know. I took you last time. Do you remember? I've been in jail already. Assault and battery by means rather, since he didn't strike you. But you're going to have to come to court. You're going to have to testify.
You're going to say, yes, Your Honor, my husband chased me around the kitchen with a knife.
Been in jail. You're going to drive it to your one of the old girls.
If you don't want to do that, you're going to have to run from your own house and go back to the house to home.
I'm just going to go to my lawyer and get a divorce. That's all.
But I tell you, I don't want to come back here and find you slapped again. All right? Can you believe that he's not going to hit you again?
Jesus.
I can't.
I'm not sure. I don't believe what I know.
You're going to have to come to court. All right? But I think you're only afraid of him.
I am very
Well, that's
much.
Why we're here.
I am very okay. much.
Well, if you let him keep it up, he's going to get away with it. Last time we gave him a break, he
that's
came back.
That's what happened all the time.
That's a man,
huh? So will you come to court?
Yeah, no.
When do I have to come?
We'll give you a summons. We'll be sent to you.
Okay.
She called.
Well, you're under arrest, all right? Just like the last time.
I'm under arrest?
Yeah. Because you had the knife and you chased him with the knife.
I didn't have no knife.
She said you did, and I don't trust you. I don't trust you, so give me a...
Okay, no, don't please.
Swing around. Hold on. Swing around. Strong bastard. Jesus. 10 times stronger than me, Bobby.
What am I arrested for?
There you go.
Come on.
No, you want to fool around, and I'm not coming back.
What am I going to arrest for?
I'm trying to give you a break.
No, what am I going to arrest for? Just say I got a knife? Okay, let me.
Shit. Why don't you put your arms down?
Okay.
Bravo 16, we have a unit up here for a transport and an arrest, please.
Okay, hold on 1 second, Evan.
Okay, can I talk now? You can say anything you want.
Well, I'm on arrest.
You just sit here.
Okay.
24 hours later, her husband was out of jail and back at the house packing his bags.
Knife on your wife, and I don't trust you.
Since then, the couple has reconciled, and in the last 6 months, the police have not been called back.
Family trouble drives me crazy. It's one thing to go into armed robbery and see a shooting or whatever, but... You know, violence in the family. I can't understand how people can love each other and want to kick each other's butt constantly, or shooting or stabbing or whatever. Then you get the calls where parents call on their 9-year-old kid and say, I can't handle him. It's like, you have to call the police to handle your kid. That's terrible. That's getting out of hand. And then, of course, it makes you crazy in the head because we have families too. So you go home after dealing with all this. It's constant, especially in Mattapan. It's about all you get is family trouble. And then you go home and you can't go home the animal that you were at work. You have to be very sensitive in your house. You have to leave all the craziness, all the madness behind your locker. And sometimes that's difficult. Sometimes if there's a lot of traffic on the expressway, it takes me an hour to get home. I'm glad because I need that hour by myself before I go on to my own house and have to deal with what's ever there, the regular everyday thing. Because you're out here, you're into everybody else's business constantly, no matter what it is. I guess it's the same probably for a psychologist. You just get so sick of listening to it that eventually it's like, I don't want to hear it anymore. Like when I go on vacation, I don't want to come to Boston if I can help it. I don't even want to see a cruiser.
That's it, gentlemen, follow.
Some cops drink. Some cops kick their dog. Some cops fight with their wives. A lot of cops get divorced. And some cops... shoot themselves. Some cops crack up. Some cops get an early retirement from injuries. Some cops quit. Some cops get fired. Some cops go to the can. Not too many cops that actually finished their 32 years on this job.
Bobby Flynn wants to make it 32 years. He grew up in all-white South Boston, but he has served all of his 7 years in this neighborhood.
Some nights you come in and there's nothing to do. Everything's quiet. And that'll be on a Friday night from... You think you come in here and you're going to be running your ass ragged. Nothing's going on. Another night you come in on a Sunday night, Monday night, in the last half, and you think there'll be nothing going on. It'll be raining, it'll be snowing, there'll be nobody out in the street, and all of a sudden the roof falls in. Can't tell. It's just the madness. It's all it is madness.
614 Dudley Street in the hallway. They're fighting with knives up there.
The radio is filled with calls about knives and guns. They pay special attention to the gun calls.
57 or something like that. Okay. Underneath the back seat, when you pull it out, there's a shotgun with all the ammunition in it. Car's just stolen. They don't know if they know the shotgun's in it.
On this warm summer night, while there's talk of guns in the air, Flynn and his partner Carlos are called to a knife fight. They hear there are two families involved. So far, it's a routine
Bravo
call.
Yes, Bravo Base. That unit
wanted.
VK1 would like you over on Channel 7.
Derek, go fuck get him.
Which one?
A green shirt. And a green coat. He's got it. He's got a gun.
The fight seems to have broken up.
Carlos are right behind us.
The two sisters tell them one of the men had a gun. Now the emotional equation in this car changes. Both Flynn and Carlos take out their own guns.
411 says he's down at Bird and Blue Hill Ave.
Which ones?
These two on the left.
Okay, the 411.
Hands on top of the car, both is. Right now.
Come on.
Right fucking now. These two here? Carlos.
They've got the wrong suspects. The two sisters have caught up with the police. They say the gun is in this house.
Sorry. Excuse me, I'm sorry.
They had the knife.
They don't
oh
want
my
to
God!
Talk about these two, my man.
Now the people in the house say the sisters had a knife. Whether there is a knife or a gun, it has raised the emotional stakes for everybody.
Hey!
Number one, get on the other side of the street.
Hey!
86 Whitfield.
On the other side of the street. Get on the other side of the street. Ollie's. Hey!
In the end, it won't be a knife or a gun, but when this woman throws her shoe, it will lead to an arrest. Because Flynn thinks it was a rock or a brick.
Get off of you!
Flynn decides to arrest the woman who threw her shoes.
Calm down!
Bravo A1 says.
No problem. I don't have no gun.
They put a gun on her. Not me.
I was in the bed sleeping.
They pulled a knife and a gun on my sister. People all the way up the street don't even involve seeing it. But they took my sister away, right? They took her away. Where's justice? There ain't no fucking justice in this country.
We're standing here and they start fucking throwing rocks and bottles at this house. They start throwing them back. I go to grab one of the broads, get her on the ground. She's the one I saw throw it, right? Yeah. Danny comes over to help me. She bit Danny in the balls.
How about her? She threw something at my sister.
Well, I saw your sister. I didn't see her.
Yes, you did.
All right?
Yes,
I got your sister. Don't tell me what I saw. I don't tell you.
She did not throw nothing. He did not have a brick in his hand, and you're not going to arrest him? He had a brick in his hand. You didn't arrest him. You don't want to take care of business?
Guess who else is going to go in about 2 seconds here? So she's got to go for assault by me. She threw the fucking brick. Number one is it just missed me.
Missed my fucking foot.
Okay. And then fucking I turned. I'm just going to put it down as a street fight.
All right. Okay, you don't want to get into it?
Not really, except
for... Bravo 416, you clear Morrow Street.
Better thing to do.
He says, she says.
Yeah.
A gun, that was a knife. You know what I mean?
No gun, no knife, no brick, no rock. Harsh words and shoes.
I seen you raise one with a fat girl. I'm holding on to the other fat girl over there.
I know that.
Danny, the canine guy.
She bit him?
Yeah. I'm the boss.
So did you like anybody
else? Yeah, a girl.
Can't lose.
I go book her.
She'll be charged with assault and battery and disorderly conduct.
Well, have you bailed out? There's nothing to get excited about the whole situation.
Just came off.
6 months later, her case is still pending.
Just relax. No sense of getting yourself all excited. You're not going to do any good. Give me attention. I'm sending down an identification by yourself. Get your picture taken, and I'll bring you back. And I'll have a bail bond in here, and we'll get you out. You'll probably release you on a small bail, but relax.
The streets are like the jungle in a way. It's like who's gonna be clever, who's gonna be cunning, who's gonna be the smartest, who's gonna like survive, who's gonna make the buck.
I have that. 504, you can disregard 104.
Knowing these streets means knowing that at any given time, the police say there are 20 hot spots where drugs are sold, behind these doors and on these corners.
All these areas up here dealing heroin, crack, regular cocaine. You can buy any quantity you want. I must say, you don't see too much marijuana up here, though. Independence, usually. See this asshole right here talking to these guys? Everybody's asking them where this shit is. Broad's dirty. I should assume so. There ain't no reason for anybody to come up here unless it is to buy drugs.
Most of these cops assume everyone is lying. Lying. They call it the song of the streets. They say a good cop can spot a liar just by driving by.
Come over here. If I see you again, you better come over here. What's your name?
Ah.
Huh?
Ah.
And what's his name?
Eddie.
Come over here, man.
Where you going, Eddie?
If I see him again, he's going to have a problem now, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Eddie! You better come on, Eddie!
Why is he running?
Huh?
He's stupid, huh?
You know why he's running? He's got some dope on him.
I don't.
Well, you don't, but he does.
I wasn't even with him.
What's his name?
Mike.
What is his name? You're
Mike
lying.
Smith.
What, you just told me his name was Eddie.
I mean Eddie.
What is it, Mike or Eddie?
Eddie.
You want to go down to the station and we'll talk about it?
No.
All right, then you want to tell me his name?
Eddie.
Eddie what?
Smith.
Ooh, well, come on, man. Come on.
That's my brother right there.
Come on.
Eddie Smith, man.
I don't want to hear Eddie Smith, okay? Why don't you go sit in the car? I'm not even going to hold you. Go sit in the car, man.
to go on the
station. Go sit in the car.
The song of the streets, the big and little lies. It's a constant refrain in a world where everyone's name is Smith.
What's your first name?
My name is David Smith.
Of course not. And your last name is Smith. How long has it been Smith?
How long has it been Smith? Since I moved from down south.
All right, where do you live now? Where do you live now, David?
On Washington Street.
What number?
56.
You didn't shoot Jamaica Joe? Johnny? What do you think, I'm crazy? I grew up here too. I know who you shoot. Every time you shoot somebody or carry a gun, I know it.
School that I went to, right? BMW. That's not stand for caddy.
I'm crazy.
You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
This is not for this guy.
I just dropped.
This here is not for this
guy. To my BMW.
This here is a photocopy of a registration
to my
for
BMW.
A motor vehicle,
right,
which
here
is not what you are driving.
You just came back from the store, right?
What kind of store?
Right?
I didn't come back from no store.
Oh, where'd you get this from?
I don't know where I got it from.
Yeah. Oh, you got two of them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe you, Joseph. I just can't believe that you'd be down there on Ziegler Street with all that fucking drug activity. You're not buying drugs.
I was down here. That wasn't any of those animals.
They sell it all over Ziegler Street. I'm not going to search it because I believe you don't have anything on you.
But I wasn't near them. I was down the end.
Okay, I'm not here to give you a hassle. It's very unusual to see a white face down there on Ziegler Street. I just want to take a quick perusal, Joe.
60, 80, 100. We're counting. You're not half, all right? Step back. 20, 40, 60, 80, 90, 200, 10, 20, 40. 50, 60, 70, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 300.
Had a busy day. My mother's out of town. I got the house. This is food.
I just got a little $300.
You act like I robbed the bank or something.
Did you?
No, I didn't.
Oh, don't tell me you did then.
Told you, Carl. So I got you.
I trust you, man. I just got to double check. You know what I'm saying?
All right.
I ain't going to jam you up. You know that.
You got a light on you?
Nah, that's all.
Watch the flame, dude.
I don't want to let it explode.
Goddamn. Expecting trouble, man?
See this young cat here?
Tell him how old you are.
15.
All right.
You're not old enough to lie.
Helping to delinquency of a minor is a criminal offense. You understand what I'm saying?
Offense for what?
You hear what I'm saying? Do you understand?
What did I do?
Do you understand what I'm saying to you? I don't have the time for you. You understand? You got two stolen rings. Chill out. You understand? You understand that?
I'm going to grab this.
All right.
Hello.
He's got hot rings anyway.
It's not even large, man.
Who dropped it?
Hey,
he planted it.
Hey,
on me. I mean, sir. That's
hey,
Mom, where was it at? Where was you get it from?
Shh.
It's not even.
You're
mine.
Giving me a headache. You understand that? You're giving me a headache. You understand that?
I was going to the store. The little guy seen a 20 on top. He said, "Let me count it." I let him count it.
My man. I've been here too many years.
Yeah.
You understand?
Uh-huh.
That kid wasn't counting your money. That kid was giving you the money. You understand?
Oh, I swear to God.
Don't swear, man.
Can
I'm
swear?
Catholic.
You know what I'm saying? Get your leg in there.
I got him, Carlos. I got him.
Get him off. Handcuff the motherfucker. Handcuff him now.
Hang
on,
man.
I got. Oh man, you broke my wrist, man.
You broke my fucking glasses.
You broke. Look at my wrist, man.
Fuck you.
Bring the blood stopping, man.
Okay.
Oh man, get off my. Man, you fucking up my wrist, man. Look at. Oh man, I can't even move my arms, man. Get in. Oh man.
What's up?
We're going with you.
K2.
Bravo
45.
Oh, my arms.
Yeah, Rick, on the way into the house to do the paperwork.
My
I got
hands,
that prisoner
sir,
on board for
sir,
the K2.
Sir,
all
my right, hands, man, is swollen up. I swear to God, man.
Get my arms, man. My hands are swelling up.
Yeah, I feel sorry for you.
My arms are swelling. Got the kids.
It's like an avalanche that keeps coming and coming. And, you know, you put your finger in here and boom, it comes out. You go over here, you know, you just can't stop it. Drugs are here to stay, let me tell you. We'll never stop it. Not at this level. You know, on the street. No way. And even when you get them good, you see what happens when you go to court. Everything's continued probation, extended probation, placed on file.
Okay, that's 6136-1122.
I think it should be as legal as bruises. You know, we could direct our police efforts in other directions. Well, they didn't break the windows, they cut the tires.
We're doing.
Building up them stats. Good score, man. Yeah. Well, we'll see you at the station.
I hope you get around.
I hope you don't get mugged on the way. Get out of here.
That film leaves us with some questions. Questions we decided to spend the rest of this program answering. But first, an update. Boston Police Headquarters.
As a very small token of our appreciation, effective today, you are now a sergeant detective.
After 26 years, Philbin has been promoted to detective. He's also been transferred from the anti-crime unit to the citywide drug unit. We showed the film to Philbin. He said he thought it was accurate and that it raised important questions about racism and drug enforcement. But he said street cops don't address those questions. So we showed the film to three people who do. People we picked because they are from different American cities and because they view the role of the police from very different perspectives. Jonathan Rubenstein, a journalist from New York who has written extensively about the police.
And I mean this not particularly reference to...
George Kelling, university professor from Boston and consultant to police departments nationwide. And Conrad Worrell from Chicago, chairperson of an organization called the National Black United Front. We wanted to hear what they had to say about the role of the police in scenes like this.
I'm sorry, excuse me.
Oh my God!
That little incident on that family dispute was nothing. And it was just completely mishandled. And they arrested a woman because she threw a shoe and bit the police. I mean, so what? I mean, I think that that was a good indication in that particular documentation of how it was mishandled. And one of the reasons it was mishandled because the white police officer really was in a flux and didn't know how to handle it.
Possibly.
I mean, that's what it seemed like to me.
I wonder if there is a good way to handle that street scene, though. In the first place, the police didn't go out looking for that incident. I'm certain they responded to a call that there were residents that were afraid. The possibility of somebody getting hurt in those kinds of events are quite great. Sure. The police come in, and they walk in, whether they're white or black, or even if they're from the community, rarely are they going to know the people. You don't know who is on which side. The people are all mixed up. You can't tell who's throwing at whom. And for the police officer to try and say, who's doing what to whom for what purpose here, is very difficult to do that kind of quick analysis. And so you start sorting things out. You tell people what to do. And you find some people are cheerleading the difficulty. Other people are goading other people on. And finally, I would guess he didn't want to arrest that woman. Finally, he decided, I've got to make a show of force to try and get control of this situation to get this to stop.
Well, see, that's just a total... difference of conception, which you just described to me about my people. First of all, everyone knows that when you know how to do something, it shows, and that you can take command. It was clear to me, what I observed, is that the white police officer was a little fearful, and he acted like he didn't know what he was doing. And so it produced a kind of continuation on the part of the black community. I have seen situations like this over and over again, and if a black police officer, particularly if he's known to the community, comes in there and tells the people to cool out, they cool out. And it's not, it doesn't escalate into some kind of rhubarb like that one, which was very minor incident.
I mean, these are very chaotic kinds of situations, and I don't care if the person coming in is white or black. It's chaos. You don't know who's fighting whom, why, and so you're trying to get control. And it's not in a control situation where it's on your stage. Police officer goes in on somebody else's stage, the street stage, if you will, and on behalf of the community, being called by the community, and trying to protect people from hurting each other, has to get control of the situation. Well, now,
yeah, but the young woman in that scene, I think, really depicted the attitude of large numbers of African American
people. Yeah, there's no justice.
There's no justice in America.
Well, whether or not there's...
And that's a fact.
Everything you say might be true, but here's a street...
They disagreed both about police strategy and the role race played in that incident. But they agreed these issues aren't unique to Boston, nor are the problems of street crime, domestic violence, and drugs.
What are they actually accomplishing? Are they taking the drugs off the street? I don't believe they are. These guys are taking great risks. They're going into people's houses. They're breaking down doors. A lot of these people are armed. You can see in this film a tremendous amount of disorder that is accompanied by all this kind of activity. And what is it really accomplishing? What are we really actually achieving?
I think skillfully used, properly supervised, with all respect for civil rights, that we can say that street enforcement of drug laws seems to have some benefit in some studies on street crime and disorder in areas.
So killing would give this kind of police work the benefit of the doubt. But Rubenstein says this kind of law enforcement is not only not productive, it's probably destructive.
The fact is, if you have in the city of Boston 2,000 or 3,000 people who are dealing drugs every day, that's what they do for a living, and most of these people who are dealing drugs are drug users. They're financing their habit. These people are completely replaceable. You can lock up every one of these nickel and dime dealers, and there'll be another 2,000 on the street replacing them. We've had this experience over and over again. What this kind of enforcement does is create disorder. It creates, at the retail end, an extreme disorder, a sense of great violence, both police violence and counter-violence by drug dealers, and a constant movement of this drug distribution from one street corner to another street corner, and it has resulted over the last 30 years in the destruction of one neighborhood after another.
89, 300. Yeah. Had a busy day.
They all believe police alone won't make these problems go away, problems which Conrad Worrell says are the fault of a basically unjust society.
And we keep looking at the victim. We don't look at the victimizers. We don't look at the system. We don't look at what produces social and human conditions, particularly as it relates to the African-American community. And when we do look at it in terms of the African-American community, we generally find whites arguing with each other over what to do to solve the problem.
Right. I think we're sitting here in this nice living room in Newton, Massachusetts, and I'm sure people who are going to be watching this show are going to say, well, thank God we got these guys keeping those people there. They're not in our neighborhood doing this kind of crap. I mean, let's be honest about that. The real issue here is how can we bring these people into our society? They're not in our society. They're kept in some kind of pocket, in some armpit. And obviously they're oppressed. They're oppressing themselves. They're drunk. They're disordered. If we have no cops doing anything, they're going to kill each other. And there are a lot of people who say, hey, that's great, good riddance to them. But we're all going to pay a price if that's going to happen. We're paying a price for this. And we're having these same discussions, obviously, current, because we haven't done anything, haven't found any way in 25 years. First, we haven't found a way to integrate our police, never mind deal with these fundamental questions of poverty, oppression, disorder, and dysfunction.
Racism, drugs, crime. If we continue to ignore the causes of these problems, they will plague our inner cities as long as there are inner cities. And street cops, like the ones you saw tonight, will continue to fight a holding action, since it is clear that neither the police nor any other institution or individual can solve these problems alone. I'm Judy Woodruff. Thank you for watching. Join us again for Frontline.
It's starting already. A process that's been called a circus, a horse race, a popularity contest.
You can get awful famous in this country in 7 days. I mean, it's phenomenal.
A special report on how the primary process worked or didn't work in 1984 and what might happen in 88. Watch So You Want to Be President next week on Frontline.
For a transcript of this program, please send $4 to Frontline, Box 322, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. Frontline is produced for the Documentary Consortium by WGBH, Boston, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding for Frontline was provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide, and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Schools, colleges, and other organizations interested in purchasing or renting video cassettes of this program may call 800-424-7963 or write PBS Video, Post Office Box 8092, Washington, D.C. 20024.